Today, let's discuss plant biology. And we know that they are a group of extremely small, obligately parasitic pathogenic agents, and the word virus, which comes from virus, which is refers to the poison or the noxious liquid. And it was in 1398 that George Research, he translated Bartholomew's Anglicus, interpreted this. He was the one who first attested this word. And we also know that this study is also called as virology. So what's happening here is that in plant virology, the field of plant pathology that deals with the study of viruses and virus-like pathogen, and specifically the diseases associated with them, is called as your plant virology. In 1981, Matthew has more specifically defined a virus as a set of one or more nucleic acid template molecules. Normally, they are encased in a protective coat or coats of proteins or lipoproteins. And this is able to organize their own replication within a suitable host cell. And such a definition clearly distinguishes a virus from other plant disease agents. For example, you have your viroid or mycoplasm, the rickettsia. These are the different type of group of bacteria which causes virus-like symptoms and diseased plants. So basically, for the reference to the development of plant virology, the first of the symptoms in plant reference is in Oyum, which was given in 1752 AD. It was Oyum by Empress Kokin and Tuliponia. And during the 17th century in Holland, the color variegation or striping of tulip petals in plants infected with tulip mosaic virus was much praised by Dutch tulipers, and the demand of infected bulbs was so great during that period that the craze became known as tulip mosaic. That's where the word is coming from. Although the cause of the tulip petal symptoms was unknown at the time, some growers knew that the condition could be grafted to a normal flowering bulb. It was Adolf Meyer in 1886 who worked on TMB, and he described the disease of tobacco and called his mosaic trachyte. He also demonstrated the sap transmission of TMB disease. Similarly, Dmitry Aronofsky in 1892, he demonstrated that causal agent of tobacco mosaic would pass through bacterial filter, chimelin filter, which is called as Nozres. And Bajajic in 1898, he was the one to conclude that the disease was not caused by a microbe, but by a Contagium vivium fluidum. He's called as the father of virology. So Stanley in 1935, he's working with TMB, reported the isolation and characterization of the virus as a crystallizable protein. And 2 years later, in 1937, Bodden and Perry reported that TMB consisted of 95% protein and 5% nucleic acid. And in 1938, they purified bushy stunt virus and showed that it contained 88% RNA. The first electron microscope picture of plant virus was taken of TMB by Bosch, Funkusch and Ruskam. It was in 1939. Another major technical advance in plant virology was the development of density gradient centrifugation, which was done by Breck in 1951. In the field of plant virology control, a major step forward was made in 1952 by Norell and Martin. They used meristem tip culture and showed that virus-free plant could be obtained from totally infected patients. Finally, other major advances have undoubtedly been the discovery of viruses with multi-component genomes. Vister in 1968 and Sanger in 1968. These are things which you can look forward to. They contain only a protein core, and they have a nucleic acid. This nucleic acid can either be DNA or RNA. It cannot be both. Nucleic acid can be single-stranded or double-stranded. This is going to make the core of the virus. And core is surrounded by a protein capsid. The shape of the capsid gives the virus its characteristic shape. Some viruses have envelope, some viruses have enzymes, some viruses are not enveloped, the non-envelope viruses, and they reproduce at a very fast rate, but they reproduce only in the living host cell. Now, the rate of mutation in virus is very fast as compared to other microorganisms. They carry out non-metabolism on their own and they must replicate using the host cell metabolic machinery. In other words, virus don't grow or divide. Instead, new viral components are synthesized and assembled within the infected host cell. Now, viruses are infectious agents with both living and non-living characteristics. Living characteristics of virus includes the ability to reproduce, but only in living host cell, and the ability to mutate. Non-living characteristics include the fact that they are not cells, they have no cytoplasm or cellular organelles, and carry out no metabolism on their own, and therefore must replicate using the host cell's metabolic machinery. Plant viruses may be isometric, that is spherical, basically formed. For example, they can have a bullet type of shape or rod shape. Isometric particles vary from 17 nanometer, the satellite virus of TMV, TNV, the primary necrosis virus, to 70 nanometer, the reovirus in diameter. Particles of basally formed virus, such as those of the rhabdovirus group, measure up to 300 nanometer in length, and they can be around 95 nanometer in width. And the elongated rod-shaped plant viruses ranges from short rigid rods measuring from 114 to 215 nanometer in length by 23 nanometer in width. For example, you have your Tobra viruses. You can also have very long viruses, which includes your Clostridioviruses. These can have size up to 2000 nanometer in length and 10 nanometer. So there are three main hypotheses regarding their origin: the progressive, the regressive, and the virus first hypothesis. The progressive or escape hypothesis states that the virus arose from genetic elements that gained the ability to move between cells. The regressive or reduction hypothesis asserts that viruses are remnant of cellular organisms. And the final, the virus first hypothesis states that viruses co-evolved with their current cellular hosts. Simplified virus life cycles include your LyTech, the virulent virus. Which kinds, what kind of cells can be infected by a virus? Any plant, animal, or bacterial cells can be infected by a virus. And the typical cycle is there in minutes. These life cycle includes your attachment, specific receive. Then you have your entry, you have synthesis, assembly, and your release. Bacteriophages, a virus that infects bacteria and usually kills them. This includes your lambda virus, phi, and 174. You've got your microphage, a double-stranded RNA virus that infects fungi and usually kills the host. Trypanosoma, parasitic and hypovirus, one. Gemini virus-related virus in the sclerotinia, sclerotium. Phycophage, a double-stranded DNA virus that infects algae and kills them. You've got your chlorovirus and pheovirus. Viroids, they are very small, covalently closed circular RNA molecules capable of autonomous replication and induction of disease. The size ranges from 250 to 450 nucleotides. There is no coding capacity. They use host encoded polymerase for replication. There's classical viroids that have been found only in plants. And cell-to-cell movement through plasmodesmata and within cell through nucleopore. Example includes your potato spindle tubovirus, coconut kadang viroid, citrus hexapodes viroid. And virusoids are extra small circular RNA components of some isometric RNA viruses. We'll talk about bacteriophages, viroids, and prions. We'll discuss their structure and properties of the bacterial viruses, and we'll discuss the lytic and lysogenic cycles. We'll also discuss the difference between viroids and prions. We Hindus have been storing Ganga water in our homes for the purpose of cleaning and rituals for centuries. Antibacterial properties of the water of Ganga and Yamuna have been characterized by Hankin in 1896, and this was long before the genesis of the concept of bacteriophages, which was developed by De Herle in 1970. Hankin, in that year, 1896, reported the cure for diarrhea and cholera by using raw Ganga water. Also, in New Times,
Notial in 2009 found the presence of self-purificatory properties in Ganga water due to its fluidity and presence of some unknown heat-liable peptides. These peptides were able to kill the pathogenic E. coli 0157H7. These were called as your bacteriophages. Bacteriophages are highly host-specific, having the ability to infect and alter the composition of microbial community. In short, they are also called as phage. All bacteria are not infected by all phages, but most phages can infect a specific species of bacteria. Bacteriophage or phages are obligate intracellular parasites of the bacteria. They may use some or all of the host biosynthetic machinery. They are much smaller than the host, obviously, which is that the bacteria, and estimated to be widely distributed and ubiquitous. That is, they can be found in all reservoirs populated by bacterial host, from soil to intestines of animals. One of the densest natural source for phage and other viruses is the seawater. They have been used for over 60 years as an alternate to antibiotics. However, this much controversial area of research. Composition of bacteriophages. Different bacteriophages may contain different material, but they all contain nucleic acid and protein. Depending upon the phage, the nucleic acid can be either DNA or RNA, but it can never be both. The shape of the bacteriophages is also different from one species to another. Typical phages have a hollow head where the genetic material is stored and a tunnel tail. The tip of the tail have the ability to bind to specific surface receptors on the target bacteria. Once attached, the viral genetic material is then injected through the tail into the host cell. Here, it directs the production of progeny phages, often over 100 in half an hour of duration. These young phages burst from the host cell, killing it and infecting more bacterial cells. Here you can see the different bacteriophage families and their different type of shapes. On the left hand top side, you will see double-stranded DNA is the nucleic acid which is inside these viruses. These viruses are non-enveloped. On the right hand side, you can see double-stranded DNA, and these are the enveloped viruses. On the left hand side bottom, you can see virus which have single-stranded DNA. In the center bottom, you can see virus Lepidoviridae which has a single-stranded RNA. And you have on the right hand side bottom Cystoviridae which has double-stranded RNA. You can see that these different viruses have different type of shapes. In the center, you will always find a nucleic acid which is either DNA or RNA. Now let's talk about phage nucleic acid and phage protein content. The nucleic acid of phages often contain unusual or modified bases. These modified bases protect the phage nucleic acid from nucleases. The size of the nucleic acid varies depending upon the phage. The simplest phage have only enough nucleic acid to code for 3 to 5 average size gene products, while the more complex phages may code for up to 100 gene products or maybe more. When we talk about the phage protein content, The number and amount of different kinds of protein, they vary from phage to phage. The simplest phage have many copies of only one or two different proteins, while more complex phages may have many different kinds of proteins. These proteins, they function in infection and to protect the nucleic acid from nucleases in the environment. For example, here you have your T4 phage. It is among the largest phages in the world. It is 200 nanometer long and 80 to 100 nanometer wide. The average range is 24 to 200 nanometer in length. The phage head can be of different types. That is, it can be icosahedral, filamentous, or head tail in shape. Many, but not all phages have tails attached to the phage head. But this T4 does have. Here you can see on the top, that is the shape is going to vary, and this is your tail. The diagram is on the right hand side top. Complex phages have contractile sheath which contracts during an infection of the bacterium. At the end of the tail, there is presence of base plate and one or more tail fibers attached to it. These are involved in binding of the phage to the bacterial cell. What's happening here is, this is your head. In the head, inside you will have your nucleic acid. This is your tail part. The tail part contains of three parts. You have your contractile sheath in the center. You have your tail fibers, which are going to recognize the bacterial surface, and the base plate, which is going to attach to the bacterial surface and make the connection permanent. So what happens is, these tail fibers, they recognize the lipopolysaccharides on the surface of the microbes, on the outer membrane of the microbial cell. Once they attach to these outer membrane lipopolysaccharides or LPS, they confirm that this is the bacteria which is the host of the virus. Then this base plate is going to attach to the surface and cause a penetrating hole, and then the contractile sheath is going to contract down just like a spring which is inside a pen, and the genetic material, which is the DNA in this case, it is going to be injected into the in cytoplasm of the bacterial cell. So let's take a look at these processes. Infection of the host cell has four steps. You have adsorption, you have irreversible attachment, you have sheath contraction, and you have finally nucleic acid injection. Let's look at adsorption. This is the first step, and it is mediated by the tail fibers or some analogous structures on the tail fibers which tail fibers, white phages. So it is a reversible process. Tail fibers, they attach to specific receptors on the bacterial cell. These receptors, they vary from different type of bacteria and different type of host. And the host specificity of the phage is usually determined by the type of tail fibers that a phage has. Example of specific receptors includes the proteins on the outer surface of the bacteria, the lipopolysaccharides, the pili, and the lipoproteins. These receptors are on the bacteria for other purposes, but phage has evolved to use these receptors for infection. Irreversible attachment. The irreversible binding of phage to the bacterium is mediated by one or more of the components of the base plate. Phages lacking base plates have other way of becoming tightly bound to the bacterial cell. Sheath contraction. The irreversible binding of the phage to the bacterium results in the contraction of the sheath, and the hollow tail fiber is pushed through the bacterial envelope just like an injection. Some phages have enzymes that digest various components of the bacterial envelope and cause a hole and help in causing that hole in an easy way. Nucleic acid injection. When the phage has gotten through the bacterial envelope, the nucleic acid from the head passes through the hollow tail and enters the bacterial cell. Usually, the only phage component that actually enters the cell is the nucleic acid. The remainder of the phage remains on the outside of the bacteria. There are some exceptions to this rule. This is different from animal cell viruses, in which most of the virus particles usually get into the cell. The difference is probably due to the inability of the bacteria to engulf materials. Now let's talk about the life cycle of these bacteriophages. Bacteriophages, just like other viruses, must infect a host cell in order to reproduce. The steps that make up the infection process are collectively called the life cycle of the phage. Some phages can only reproduce via a lytic life cycle. In this case, they burst and kill their host cells. Other phages can alternate between a lytic life cycle and a lysogenic life cycle, in which they don't kill the host cell, but instead the DNA is copied along with the host DNA each time the cell divides. We'll look into it in details in the next few slides. The lytic cycle and the lysogenic cycle. In the lytic cycle, the phage infects the bacterium, hijacks the bacterium to make lots of phages, and then kills the host cell by exploding it or by lysis. In the lysogenic cycle, the phage infects a bacterium and inserts its DNA into the bacterial chromosome. This allows the phage DNA, now called as a prophage, to be copied and passed on along with the cell's own DNA. The stages of the lytic cycles are: attachment is the first step. Proteins in the tail of the phage bind to a specific receptor In this case, a sugar transporter on the surface of the bacterial cell. Entry, the phage injects its DNA or RNA genome into the cytoplasm of the bacteria. The DNA copying and protein synthesis. The phage DNA is copied and phage genes are expressed to make protein such as capsid proteins. Assembly of new phage. Capsid assembles from capsid proteins and are stuffed with DNA to make lots of new phage particles. Lysis. Late in the lytic cycle, the phage expresses genes for proteins that poke holes in the plasma membrane and cell wall. The holes let water flow in, making the cell expand and burst like an overfilled water balloon. In this diagram, you can see the lytic cycle. Here is the first step of attachment. This is your bacterial cell. This is your phage particle. The phage particle, with the help of contractile sheath and the base plate, it attaches to the surface, and once it has permanently attached itself, it injects its genetic material into the bacterium. Here, DNA replication and protein synthesis takes place. The DNA makes many copies of itself inside the cell using the host cellular machinery. It prepares the capsid proteins. Then it is going to assemble these viruses inside the bacterial cell. And then it is going to lyse the cell, causing the cell to burst open, allowing all the newly assembled phage particles to release into the environment. Once in the environment, each new phage particle can go and attach to new different bacterial cell. The stages of the lysogenic cycle. Most phages are either purely lytic, sometimes called as virulent phages, or capable of switching between lytic and lysogenic cycles, sometimes also called as temperate phages. The lysogenic cycle allows the phage to reproduce without killing its host. Attachment is the first step. Here, proteins in the tail of the phage bind to the specific receptors, again, in this case, sugar transporters, which are available on the outer surface of the bacterial cell. The entry of the phage is not the whole phage, but what it does is it injects its genetic material into the cytoplasm of the bacterial cell. DNA copying and protein synthesis. Once the phage DNA is inside the cell, it is not immediately copied or expressed to make proteins. Instead, it recombines with a particular region of the bacterial chromosome. That is, it is integrated into the host chromosome. Here you can see the diagram of the lysogenic cycle. The bacterium or the bacterial cell, it gets attached by the phage particle. The phage injects its genetic material. This genetic material integrates itself into the bacteria's chromosome. This phage DNA, that is, it recombines with the bacterial chromosome. and thus it becomes prophage. Now, every time this cell is going to divide, it is going to make many cells with the prophage. And when the time will come, when the environmental factors will be in favor of the lytic phage, then these prophage genetic material is going to start with destruction of the cell and reproduction of virus particle. The integrated DNA, phage DNA, which is called as the prophage, is not active. That is, its genes aren't expressed as yet, and it doesn't drive production of new phages. However, each time the host cell will divide, the prophage is going to be copied along with the host DNA, getting a free ride. Under the right condition, the prophage can become active and come back out of the bacterial chromosome, triggering the remaining steps of the lytic cycle. DNA copying and protein synthesis, phage assembly and lysis. To lyse or not to lyse is the question. How does a phage decides whether to lyse or not to lyse? How does it decide what stage to enter, lytic stage or lysogenic stage? One important factor is the number of phages infecting the cell at once. Large number of co-infecting phages makes it more likely that the infection will use the lysogenic cycle. This strategy may help prevent the phages from wiping out their bacterial host. That is, by reducing down the attack, the phage to host ratio gets too high. What triggers a prophage to pop back out of the chromosome and enter the lytic cycle? At least in the laboratory, the DNA damaging agents like UV radiation and certain chemicals will trigger most prophages in the population to reactivate. However, a small fraction of the prophages in the population, they spontaneously go lytic even without these external cues. Bacteriophages versus antibiotics. Before antibiotics were discovered, there was considerable research on bacteriophages as a treatment for human bacterial diseases. Bacteriophages, they attack only their host bacteria and not human cells. So, they are potentially good candidate to treat bacterial diseases in humans. After antibiotics were discovered, the phage approach was largely abandoned in many parts of the world, particularly the English-speaking countries. However, phages continued to be used for medical purposes in a number of countries, including Russia, Georgia, and Poland. They are still used there today. There is increasing interest in bringing back the phage approach elsewhere as antibiotic resistant bacteria are becoming more and more of a problem. Research is still needed to see how safe and effective phages are, but who knows? One day your doctor might write you a prescription for a phage instead of penicillin. Viroids and prions. Viroids are the smallest infectious pathogens known. They are composed solely of a short strand of circular single-stranded RNA, which has around 300 nucleotides. It has no protein coating. They do not code for any protein, and they are inhabitants of higher plants. And most of these viroids, they cause diseases in higher plants. Prions, on the other hand, are misfolded proteins with the ability to transmit their misfolded shape onto normal variants of the same protein. The word prion derives from proteinaceous infectious particles. They characterize several fatal and transmissible neurodegenerative diseases in humans and many other animals. It is not known what causes the normal proteins to misfold, but the abnormal 3D structure is suspected of conferring infectious properties, collapsing nearby protein molecules into the same shape. These prions can bind to plants and be taken into the roots, where they may travel to the stems and leaves. Therefore, it is possible that prions excreted by deer or rat or human can pass on to other animals, such as grazing cows, and through them even to humans, and especially if you have a prion infected plant and humans consume it, then the humans may also get infected.
Diseases caused by rigid broad single stranded ssRNA viruses include TMB, tobacco mosaic virus, or tobacco retrovirus, TRV. Diseases caused by filamentous single stranded RNA virus includes your bean common mosaic virus, papaya ring spot virus, sugarcane mosaic, watermelon mosaic, etc. Diseases caused by clusteroviruses include your citrus, Treviso virus, beak yellow mosaic, etc. Diseases caused by isometric single-stranded RNA viruses include your rice, tundra spherical virus, cucumber mosaic virus, grapevine, fan leaf virus, etc. Diseases caused by DNA viruses include isometric double-stranded DS virus, cauliflower mosaic virus. Diseases caused by Gemini single-stranded DNA virus includes beak curly top virus, maize streak virus, bean cold mosaic virus. Diseases caused by isometric single-stranded DNA virus, example includes a banana top virus, coconut foil or decay virus. Their transmission can be both via insects and humans, pests. So, aphid transmitted viruses include citrus tissue virus, bean common mosaic virus, cucumber mosaic virus. Leafhopper transmitted virus includes rice, tableau virus, beet curly top virus, potato yellow dwarf. White fly transmitted viruses include tobacco curl leaf, cotton leaf curl, soybean, yellow mosaic virus. B2 transmitted virus includes cowpea mosaic virus, squash mosaic virus. Thrip transmitted virus includes tomato spotted wilt virus. They are viruses which can be transmitted via mites. These include white streak mosaic virus. Then you have your virus transmitted by nematodes. The nematode vectors belong to the order Torlai-Romita and include species from the genera Trichodorus, Teratrichodorus, Longidorus, and Cyphnidina. These examples include grapevine fan leaf virus transmitted by Cyphnidina index, the early browning virus transmitted by Peratrichodorus and Trichodorus species, and then there are some viruses which are transmitted by fungus also. These include your Polymyxia and Sporangiospora species, plasmid diphyrates. They transmit a number of viruses which include your wheat soil corn mosaic virus and potato mockup virus. Plant-to-plant transmission of virus has also been seen. Transmission by vegetative propagation example includes your apple mosaic virus has been reported to be transmitted by grafting. Mechanical transmission includes your tobacco mosaic virus, potato virus, cucumber mosaic virus. Seed transmission includes your tomato mosaic virus, peppermint mottle virus. Oral transmission includes your tumorous necrotic ring spots. Then you have your common symptoms shown by virus-infected plants. It includes your puckering, which is like a pouch-like development, vein clearing, yellowing of the cells near the veins, leaf rolling, rolling of leaves due to accumulation of starch, sevoing, hyper or hypoplasia, epinasty, overgrowth on upper surface, varicence, hypochronic symptoms. Basic management practices include your elimination of source of infection, avoidance of source of infection, avoidance of the vector, chemical control of vector, non-chemical control of vector, controls by cross-pollination, cross-protection, and use of resistant cultivar. Industrial packaging materials are different from traditional packaging material. In addition to material, attractive design is also preferred. Packaging comes in many different forms based on technical requirements for the supply chain as well as marketing needs, like brand identity, consumer information, and other criteria. So what's happening in these industrial packaging materials is that they have a special coating which along with a different type of design is there to inactivate a particular type of virus on the surface. You have your mosaic, tomato mosaic virus is one of the examples. The symptoms include the disease is characterized by light. The disease is characterized by light and dark green mottling. The leaves often accompanied by wilting and young leaves in sunny days. When plant first becomes infected, the leaflets of affected leaves are usually distorted, puckered, and smaller than normal. The affected plant appears stunted, pale green, and spindly. This is one of the images you can see. Survival and spread. The virus is spread by contact with clothes, hands of working labor, touching of infected plants with healthy ones, plant debris and implements. Management includes seeds from disease-free healthy plants should be selected for sowing. Soaking of the seeds in a solution of trisodium phosphate, that is 90 gram per liter of water a day before sowing. The seeds should be thoroughly rinsed and dried in shade to avoid any infection or fungus. In the nursery, all the infected plants should be removed carefully and destroyed. And crop rotation with crop other than tobacco, potato, chili, capsicum, brinjal should be undertaken. Alternate hosts should be avoided. The have your papaya mosaic virus. It's economically very important. In India, it was first reported from Mumbai, Pune, and occurs more in central India now. It has a damage rate of 90 to 100% in severe cases. And virus is a body virus with it has long flexes, rod shaped particles, having a single stranded RNA as genome. Symptoms include your mottling and puckering of leaves, especially the young ones. And water soaked chlorotic spots on tender stems and petioles. You can see those water soaked chlorotic spots. The lamina is reduced and malformed and are often modified into tendrils like structures, giving a shoestring appearance. Decline and marked reduction in growth of disease plant. Understood. Older leaves fall down and small tuft of younger leaves is left at the top in upright position. Rooting develop innumerable circular water-soaked spots with concentric rings. And the fruit size is severely reduced with deformed shape. Here you can see the papaya mosaic virus.